Good afternoon, everyone. Okay, come on. I just spoke to a bunch of seventh graders, and they were like, good afternoon. So good afternoon, everyone. That's so exciting. I'm so happy that you all are here, and welcome to this year's Chicago Summit on STEM Equity and Excellence. My name is Chevy Humphrey, and I am the president and CEO here at the Museum of Science and Industry. I've been here 2.5 years. I came from Phoenix, and people go, you left the sun for the cold. But I actually landed at MSI, and it is the best museum in the world. So I'm super excited about being here and the work that the team does. But before I start, I just wanted to have the team, MSI team, stand up to give them a round of applause. You know, we are not MSI without these special people. And our volunteers, which is a part of our team. So thank you so much. We cannot do our work if we didn't have an incredible team. So thank you. I'm truly delighted to have each of you here today. And I want to extend a special thanks to everyone who made this event possible, and especially our partners at STEMM Opportunity Alliance and all the distinguished speakers and panelists who will share their expertise with us. Today's summit embodies the spirit of collaboration when we prioritize discussions like the ones we'll have today. We open up doors to create a brighter and more inclusive future for the next generation. Whether it is in formal classrooms, museums, or through community outreach, such opportunities for students to learn about science is important and a chance to inspire them. I always go off script, so I'm going off script now. I literally just got back from Phoenix, and before I left Arizona Science Center, I'd been there 23 years. They asked, "What we want to honor your leadership. What can we do?" And they were looking for these big gifts to give me, et cetera, and I said, I don't want that. I want to continue the work of inspiring young people in science. And so we created the Chevy Humphrey Women in STEM Scholarship. And I am so thrilled. One of the caveats is that I wanted to make sure that a young woman had the opportunity to break that barrier. Women only represent 29% of women in science and in STEM careers. And I want to break that barrier. And that program is going to break that barrier. Zara is from Iraq. She is a Muslim American. She won the award, and I told her she is going to be that next neuroscientist that's going to break that barrier. She won the award, and I'm just so proud. And the work that all of you do make this possible. So I would like to say, everybody go back to your communities and find that young person to inspire them and help them to realize their full potential and their dreams. So I just wanted to say that it's important for us to inspire everyone. So I'll go back on script. Throughout the day, we will have the opportunity to provide essential guidance on the National Strategy for STEM Equity and Excellence. Your contributions and expertise will play a pivotal role in shaping the future of STEM education, ensuring inclusivity and equal opportunities for all learners. Oh, and one thing I forgot, every woman that gets this award, I've designated that it has to be a woman of color. So at MSI, advancing STEM equity is a major goal of ours. In our effort to inspire science learners of all ages, we aim to create transformational learning experiences that entertain while they help people understand and navigate the role of science in their own lives. By working with our communities, we combine innovation, collaboration, and engagement to enable widespread access to high-quality STEM experiences. Through strategic partnerships and collective action, we can break down barriers that impede STEM equity. You'll hear today about some of those strategies, as well as discuss with each other ways you can support inclusive learning experiences that empower students to excel in the STEM fields. As we engage in discussions today, it is critical that we seek new perspectives and collaboration on ways to equip the next generation with the skills and knowledge they need to tackle the complex challenges of tomorrow. I want to express my heartfelt appreciation to all of you again for being a part of this summit. Your dedication and commitment to STEM equity and excellence are what drives this progress. I'm confident that our collective efforts will make a lasting impact on the lives of countless young minds. Thank you for being champions of equitable STEM education, and thank you for joining us today. Now I'd like to pass it on to Manny. Manny, come on up.
I've been told not to go off script, so this is going to be pretty dry and quick, all right? Good morning, everyone. My name is Manny Juarez. I'm the Senior Director of Creativity and Innovation Programs in our Education Department here at MSI. And again, a thank you and a shout out to all my MSI partners and volunteers, our leader, Jessica Chavez. Oh, there we go. Okay, thank you. See, I'm a rookie at this. Jessica Chavez, who has a really terrific title, Vice President of Education and Chief Learning Partnership Officer. So I want to just give a shout out to her, helping put this together. So thank you, Jessica. Okay, so I'll get back to the script. I want to introduce Dr. Shirley Malcolm, who is the Senior Advisor to the CEO and Director of Sea Change at AAAS. She's well known for her 40-plus years of leadership and visionary work at AAAS to increase diversity, equity, inclusion, and access in STEM. Starting with the landmark study she co-published in 1976, The Double Bind, which was the first study to shine a light on the barriers that women of color face in STEM. She's been a fierce advocate for the inclusion of all people in STEM. For this work, she has received many awards, including the Public Welfare Medal of the National Academy of Sciences and University of Washington's Alumna Summa Laude Dignata Award. Hope I said that right. That was a lot. Dr. Malcolm is a trustee of Caltech, a regent of Morgan State University, and a former member of the National Science Board, the policymaking body of the National Science Foundation, and served on President Clinton's Committee Action of Advisors on Science and Technology. She received her PhD in ecology from Penn State, master's from UCLA, and bachelor's from the University of Washington, both in zoology. In addition, she holds 16 honorary degrees and has served on the boards of too many foundation organizations to name. Whew. Okay, that's all I've got. So I want to introduce Dr. Shirley Malcolm.
Manny, in truth, I am a sucker for a sob story, so somebody says, can you be on this committee? I end up saying, oh, okay. Let me begin by thanking the museum for hosting us. This is really special for us to be here in Chicago and be here at the Museum of Science and Industry. And for the kind of really warmth that we feel when we come in here and know that the kind of work that we know needs to be done is being done. And so that for us is really, really exciting. We also want to thank the Doris Duke Foundation, who has helped us kind of co-create this whole alliance idea and then put the money behind it. I mean, lots of people have ideas, but when they actually put the money with the ideas, that is absolutely crucial, and we have had them as a real partner all along. And I want to acknowledge and thank the White House for working with us and Doris Duke in developing this overall vision for the Science Opportunity Alliance. And when this summit happened at the White House in December, we could not have envisioned where it would take us and how it would basically be picked up by people as though it's an idea whose time has come. And I want to play that out a little bit, this notion that it is an idea whose time has come. AAAS has a long history of involvement with diversity, equity, and inclusion in STEM, science, technology, engineering, mathematics, and medicine. Over 50 years of involvement. I became a part of that history in 1975. Yes, I am old. I had left a tenure track faculty position at the University of North Carolina, Wilmington, and relocated to the DC area when I married. I joined the staff as a research assistant on a National Science Foundation funded project to identify programs and projects that had been undertaken to bring more minorities into the sciences, engineering, and biomedical fields. The project spoke to me. It had real significance because I had always wondered where everybody was. When I went to school, where was everybody? Everybody else. I had experienced and it had to overcome many of the challenges in my own educational journey. And from the under-resourced schools in the Jim Crow South, from what Martin Luther King Jr. once called the most segregated city in America, Birmingham, Alabama, to a predominantly white institution, the University of Washington. So I not only had to battle the fact that I had not had the education that I really needed in order to be able to easily slot into the requirements from the University of Washington, but I had the additional social and cultural adjustment to make from an all-black community, an all-black school, having only ever been taught by black teachers, to a place that had no black faculty, and where I was often the only one or one of a few in whatever class that I took. The cultural change, the loneliness, the aloneness, and sometimes the lower expectations because they don't expect to see me. I don't look like who they expect to see. And those were the things that I had to address. And those were the things that I found in the projects that I was working on to try to identify how to bring more minorities into the sciences and engineering and medicine. The kinds of things that the intervention programs were trying to address were the kinds of things that I had experienced. But I also knew that these were just gap measures. This was just kind of filling in around the edges, designed to help those of us for whom the institutions were never created and to try to figure out how to navigate these foreign waters. I finished my degrees, became a tenure track faculty member, and after a stint being a research assistant and a stint as a program officer at the National Science Foundation, I returned to AAAS where I have been for almost 45 years. The organization has been an incredible steward of the commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion. We've had to look at the legal aspects, such as in our work with Standing Our Ground and diversity in the law, where we were trying to figure out, when the law says you can't do something, how can you do your own kind of workaround in ways that are legal, but that actually work as well? And then there is this initiative that we have started looking at how to help institutions transform, how to help them move from where they are and how they were created into what they need to be going forward in order to serve all students well. And that is the challenge that we face here now, today, with regard to changing the STEM ecosystem. All of the component parts, how it comes together, and how it needs to work. But at the time, we've always known we needed to do this, but at the time we didn't have the power, and we didn't have the partners. And I think that that is what makes the difference, that it has been identified as a national need, as a strategic moment in time, and that we have partners like the groups that are here. You're doing this good out there in the community, but could we do so much better by working together, by aligning not just for projects, but to change the system in ways that it benefits and serves all? So that's how SOA is unique, the STEM Opportunity Alliance. We are focused on systems change. We're not just going to be satisfied with a program that's over here or over there. We think that the system needs to look more like these programs and needs to serve the students in ways that are more like these efforts that you are putting forward. The other thing that is different is that we aren't just doing this alone. It's not just those of us in the nonprofit world and the community. The industry is identifying the fact they need people. And they've also identified that diverse perspectives basically give them better products. They have figured out that it is connected to their bottom line. And so when we look at all of these things and how to bring these pieces together, how to collect the data to know how well we're doing, and how to stay on course, how to experiment when we need to, how to develop communities, how to implement strategy, and how we can bring all of the ecosystem parts together. I am thrilled to be able to announce 6 new partners for the STEM Opportunity Alliance: Community Share, Journal of Science Policy and Governance, Thermo Fisher Scientific, National Center for Women in Information Technology, Oregon STEM, and Whiz Girls. And let's just acknowledge these partners coming on board. We need you, we need the brain trust that is here. You have been working in this space. We need to hear what needs to happen inside of that national strategy that we're trying to pull together. Not only developing the plan, but carrying it out around issues of implementation. Now, my boss, I'm here because my boss isn't here, Sudip Parikh, who is the CEO of AAAS and the executive editor of Science, the Science Family of Journals. But Sudip always talks about his vision. And I just want to share this notion of his vision that any kid born today, wherever, the Imperial Valley, whether it's the center of Chicago, whether it is Southwest Texas, wherever the kid happens to be, and whoever the kid happens to be, that they should feel that they can choose a place in STEM and that there will be a place for them where they will belong. We want to move to where one can find a place in STEM because of the actions and environments of institutions and organizations, not in spite of the actions and environments. So we welcome all of you to this visioning and welcome your input on how we might all go forward together. And I thank you.